On the second floor of a former townhouse in Manchester Square, now a national museum, you'll find one of the most beautiful paintings in the world. Made in oil on canvas in sparkling pastel hues, it's a fairly small work, measuring 65 by 80 centimeters. Hanging in a gilded frame, it fairly leaps off the wall in an explosion of pink and green. Look closer, and the pink resolves itself into the form of a young woman in a ruffled dress. She's outdoors, shown in an act of play, sitting on a cushioned swing that is suspended from an old oak tree. On the ground below her, a young man looks up with an expression of admiration. And in the air between them hovers a little pink slipper. It has been kicked off her outstretched foot as she swings higher and higher in the air. You've probably seen this painting before. The swing is undoubtedly the best-known 18th century French painting of the Wallace Collection. In 1782, it was engraved as one of Fragonard's most popular and best-known works. From this moment onward, the swing became a household image, and in the 21st century, it has appeared extensively in popular culture, advertising, and contemporary artistic production. Paradoxically, the fact that the swing has been so extensively reproduced means that people rarely see it as a tangible work of art. This oil painting has the dubious honor of having become an icon, a chocolate box image, a prepackaged item that no one bothers to unwrap. But what's its story? I want to start with the maker. Jean-Honoré Fragonard is shown here in a series of sketched self-portraits from the late 1770s and 1780s, as well as in a portrait by fellow artist Jacques Lemoine. Fragonard was born in Grasse, the perfume capital of France, in 1732. During his childhood, he moved to Paris with his family. His parents had had financial problems, and his mother was determined to apprentice him to a notary, that is, a lawyer. But we have it from his grandson that Fragonard only ever wanted to study art. Eventually, his parents relented, and Fragonard found his way into the studio of François Boucher, who was at that time the first painter to the king. Boucher is an artist I want to focus on for a few moments, because he is another major protagonist for the Wallace Collection. He was the hands-down favorite painter of the fourth Marquess of Hartford, who bought the majority of our French paintings, leaving us in the process with more than 20 works by Boucher. In Boucher's own lifetime, he had the favor of Madame de Pompadour. She was the mistress and confidant of Louis XV, and an immensely intellectual art collector in her own right. It was for this royal patron that Boucher made his spectacular Rising and Setting of the Sun, the two huge and colorful canvases that grace our main staircase. Boucher's influence on Fragonard was considerable. As you can see from the painting shown here, Boucher was a very accomplished colorist, probably the best of his generation. One of the things he and Fragonard have in common are these very bold, unexpected color contrasts: blue juxtaposed with orange, or green with pink, the latter being especially on show in the swing. The other thing the Rising and Setting of the Sun tell us in their own way is that Fragonard didn't go to Boucher's studio intending to end up painting diminutive confections like the swing. These are huge paintings celebrating the life of Apollo. They were intended to dazzle and inspire the viewer with a sense of the power of the gods. For Fragonard, Boucher's studio represented official art at its apex. Boucher was, after all, the first painter to the king, and his primary responsibility was for large-scale mythological paintings like these. At this moment in French art, paintings, and the artists who made them, were organized hierarchically by genre. Large-scale mythological, religious, or classical scenes sat at the very top of this hierarchy. They were collectively known as history paintings. They were followed by portraits, scenes of everyday domestic life, landscapes, and then still lives. This was a restrictive and fairly closed system, with little room for deviation, but it endured because everyone subscribed to it.
Boucher was a history painter, and as his student, Fragonard was on the same path. And Fragonard did so well in Boucher's studio that he was quickly tipped as being the new leader of the French school, the up-and-coming artist who was going to uphold the hierarchy of genres. He was sent to Italy to finish his schooling, and when he returned to Paris, he began to take the art world by storm. The history painting shown here became a sensation in Paris during the year of 1765. It shows a young priest who heroically kills himself in the place of the woman he loves. People were so moved by this scene of noble self-sacrifice that the crown commissioned a new work from him for a huge sum.
But here's where his career plans take an unexpected twist. Because even though he was celebrated, the government didn't actually pay him for another 7 years.
Fragonard didn't come from a wealthy family. And as the story goes, he was obliged to pawn his clothing to buy art supplies during this difficult time. Eventually, he began to consider taking on private commissions that were perhaps less prestigious than painting for the government, but certainly more lucrative.
It's at this crucial point that he was approached by an unnamed gentleman of the court who asked him to take on a commission so scandalous that another artist had already turned it down.
This patron's words were published by a contemporary writer, and apparently he said, "I want you to paint my mistress on a swing, being pushed by a bishop, and to show me in a position where I can see her legs and more." Fragonard took on the commission and never looked back. From then on, he painted exclusively for the private sphere, and his handling and style changed in the process. It was just a few years later that he made his superb fantasy figures, a series of portraits of individuals in masquerade costume. These are colorful paintings that display an astonishing freedom of brushwork. Although they represent prominent individuals, some of them high-ranking aristocrats, these are paintings that are a far cry from standard old master court portraiture. In handling and color palette, they herald the dawn of Impressionism and move definitively away from the official aesthetic in which Fragonard had been trained. In the process, he distanced himself from the bureaucracy and constrictions and received notions of French official art. In the swing, Fragonard is already on this path. Closer looking indicate that it's a far more complex image than it initially seems. There's a risque element, certainly, but it's far from being frivolous or crude. In fact, the more one looks at this work, the more it seems laden with an air of menace. For one thing, Fragonard has chosen to include on the far left-hand side of his image a statue by the artist Étienne Maurice Falconet, a work that was commonly known as Menacing Cupid, because, of course, love is far from safe. For another thing, the rope that binds the swing to the tree is just starting to fray. And finally, there's the elderly man who holds the swing, smiling and seemingly oblivious for the moment. But he doesn't look like a bishop. Who is he? A third wheel always introduces an element of uncertainty.
If nothing else, the presence of danger alongside beauty makes this image a sadder, more wistful, and more ambiguous one. And in this ambiguity, there is a clear move away from the moralistic messaging of official art toward what Fragonard wanted to paint.
Ultimately, the swing is a reminder of how idiosyncratic and enigmatic Fragonard's work becomes. In the swing, as in the fantasy figures, and everything else he made going forward, he dedicated himself to presenting narratives that are hidden, that need to be unpicked, that give the viewer room to interpret.
When I look at the swing, I see a very beautiful painting made by an artist just hitting the peak of his powers. Because the swing also reveals the extraordinary quality of Fragonard's technique.
The precision and texture with which the foliage and flowers have been rendered, the fluffy coat of the little dog, the painterly handling of the sculpture in which two little cupids wrestle a dolphin, the overall sense of atmosphere and light that filters into this leafy glade. But I also think about how terrifying it must have been for Fragonard to take his fate into his own hands, to move away from everything he had known and the training he had. I see the painting as emblematic of that moment of breaking loose, taking everything he learned and stepping into the space of intellectual and creative freedom. For me, it's a tremendously rebellious and inspirational work.
When you next visit the Wallace Collection, either in person or online, I hope you'll take a moment to engage with the swing and interpret it for yourself.